What I think it does is it makes someone who's very average better. It makes somebody who's really good superb.
Hi, I'm Lidia Fonseca, Chief Digital and Technology Officer at Pfizer. In a world transformed by AI and technology, knowledge drives progress more than ever. In this episode of The Power of Knowing, I'm thrilled to chat with my guest, General Stan McChrystal, about leading through rapid technological and societal change. Stan McChrystal is a retired four-star Army general, often called one of America's greatest warriors. He led global counterterrorism operations and was appointed by President Obama as commander of U.S. and NATO forces in Afghanistan. Together, we'll explore the challenges and opportunities for leaders to embrace technological innovation while maintaining clarity and trust. Let's dive into the power of knowing. Stan, great to see you. Thank you so much for coming. These days, Stan brings his leadership skills to the private sector, running a leadership development consultancy, the McChrystal Group.
My father was a soldier, his father was a soldier, my brothers were soldiers, Annie's father was a soldier, so I sort of reflexively became a soldier. And luckily, I turned out to really like it. I went to West Point at age 17, and then I was in uniform till I was just about to turn 56. And I loved it, but what it did was it gave me, I think, a foundation of good values, some personal discipline, a lot of good friends and comrades. But the thing of leaving the service and doing something different also opened up, starting with that foundation, it opened up to learn about things, to learn about healthcare, to learn about a whole bunch of things I just never had to think about. I remember when the World Health Organization, a doctor called me after I left the service, just to thank me because I'd helped them with polio vaccinations in Afghanistan.
Interesting.
We'd actually cut a deal with the Taliban so that they could get access to people who otherwise wouldn't get the vaccine. But you suddenly start to understand the impact. It's not just a military problem, it's not just a political problem, it's a people issue.
It's about people at the end of the day. Right. So your example, right, here you are, the Taliban is an enemy, but healthcare is a connective tissue.
That's right.
That we all share in common.
That's
so
right.
So I think it's it just shows the power of what's possible.
That's right, that's what it's all about.
General McChrystal's experience in managing large-scale operations and adapting to real-time intelligence offers invaluable lessons for navigating this complex and changing landscape. I'd like to start with a hot question off the bat. What was your aha moment when, with AI, when you realized its potential?
Yeah, I was always a technology enthusiast. I was the first guy that I know to buy a Radio Shack computer, take it to my Army office. I paid for it. Cost me like $4,000 at the time. But we ran my infantry company on it. We ran our supply, we ran our training schedules and whatnot. You know, it was pretty limited. But it started me being really interested into what the potential was. If you think of the D-Day invasion of Normandy, it took about 2 years for this army of planners to do all the detailed logistical planning, communications, maneuver, just to crank it out. And then you started to see the capability to do that in these really compressed timelines. And you could check different options. You could do exploratory what-ifs. And suddenly AI went from being this very sort of murky idea to something that was very practical. I suddenly became a believer that if we used data and we used it effectively, we were going to be better than our competitors. Our special operations missions used to be very complicated and something would always go wrong. And the key was knowing what your options were. Do you remember that scene from the movie Apollo 13 where they bring in all the pieces, they throw them on a table, and they say you gotta figure out something to solve the problem up there, and this is all they've got. If you think what AI would do with that, and then expand that to COVID or something, you suddenly say, these are all the capabilities we have. How could they be used? And no human can go through enough iterations to do that by themselves. So I'm excited by that.
When it comes to rapid technological change, specifically AI, What leadership challenges stand out?
If I put on my military hat, but I think it applies everywhere, AI is going to do some things that we're not ready for yet. One, it will do some things autonomously, like weaponry. It will just do things. And we are going to have to be prepared to give up that control. And that's a little scary because, of course, there's vulnerabilities there. The other thing is it's going to give us answers without explaining how it reached the answer. And you're going to be put with that situation. Do I act on that information or do I wait until, you know, I have full proof? Well, we know in many things in life, they're military things, but something like a pandemic, if you wait until it's obvious, it's too late.
Mm-hmm.
And so if, for example, AI was tomorrow to tell us there was going to be a horrible return of a terrible, we'll call it smallpox or something, that we weren't prepared for, would we make the investments and the really important decisions that have to be made just on what the machine told us?
It's a good question.
It's going to be tough.
Yes.
Tough for decision makers.
You're absolutely right, right? Because we're excited about the fact that AI agents can reason and they can perform tasks.
Right.
If you think about large language models, right? They process information, you give an input and it'll generate an output. AI agents can actually perform tasks.
Right.
They can perform instructions, right. They can do things. And so I think it will be, you know, pretty important for us to make sure that just like in math, if you remember all of our math courses, we couldn't just show the answer,
yeah.
Right? We had to show how we got to that answer. And I do think it's going to be important for us as we develop those AI agents to make sure that we also have the traceability and the decision trees. And I do think we need to think of AI as not only helping us to summarize, but how do we use it in such a way that it amplifies our ability to still do the critical
yeah.
thinking and to still be in a position, you know, to make decisions. I think that's going to continue to be, you know, something that we all will need to adapt to, right?
So what I think it does is it makes someone who's very average better. It makes somebody who's really good superb. It's actually disproportionately value to them. So the difference between somebody who is really talented and very motivated, because that tool, they'll use it so much more. And I think that will be an interesting effect on the marketplace for talent and jobs.
That's a great point. What are the biggest leadership lessons, you know, from your military experience that apply to companies undergoing digital and AI transformation?
We all say we love change, and none of us really do. We really struggle with being adaptable. And so I think the most important thing leaders can do is communicate. And when I talk about communicating, you're first saying, okay, we have a requirement for change. There's an imperative for us to change because what we are capable and good at now is not sufficient to be what we want to be. Maybe even survive as an organization. So communicate first the need. And it takes a while. People need to be brought along. It's a series of conversations and whatnot that allow them to believe that. And then as you say, what are we going to do about it? One of the things I learned as a more senior leader is I never had the right answer. And if I was arrogant enough to think I did and I walked in and said, okay, everybody, here's the right answer, this is what we're gonna do, they wouldn't have been part of the solution. Mm. So it was much better for me to go in, admit I didn't have the right answer and say, but I do know we've gotta do this. So I need everybody engaged in helping craft the right answer. And of course, we all know that we all are much more enthusiastic about doing something we feel we're a part of the decision on. And so I think leaders become, it's not our wisdom or our knowledge, it's our ability to motivate people, to make them feel like a part of it, and to leverage their skills.
When people are invested personally in something, it's going to be more meaningful. So that definitely resonates. You have led teams through incredibly complex situations and environments. What principles have served you well in times of change and in times of crisis and transformation. How do you think those principles apply in this time of technological revolution that we're experiencing?
Understanding what the situation is a lot harder than it used to be because it's changing so fast. So even getting an appreciation for what's happening is hard. And so I think that appreciation has to come from across the organization because everybody out there is not just a recipient of information, they are a gatherer and sharer of information, and they all sort of bring it back. It's a shared consciousness is the term we use, which is a common contextual understanding. So I think that becomes key, which meant and means for leaders that I had to change. When you're put in a big job where you've got authority and a little bit of stature, you go through this idea that I ought to have all the answers because they put me in this job. I don't think that's the job. I don't think you're supposed to have the answers. I think you are supposed to be a facilitator to get to the answer.
Yep.
And that was a change for me.
It's not about you anymore.
Right.
It's about how do you work effectively through others? How do you approach building teams so that they're more adaptable?
It is about creating the culture. And we use that word all the time, but I think it's the best because culture is what people do. It's what they figured out works and what they do. For example, I once told a friend of mine that he's a corporate leader that he could go in tomorrow and be an effective general in the Army. And Lydia, I would tell you the same thing. We could put a uniform on you. It would take you a couple weeks to learn some of the terms. And then you'd be an effective general officer. The term general, a lot of people don't know this, means general. It means not specific. And the idea is by the time you reach that level, you're not an infantryman or a pilot or an intel officer. You are a general leader. So you know a little about a lot of things.
Like general management.
That's exactly. And so the key is what you really know is how to get people to work together. It's as simple and as complicated as that, because while I say it simply, we know that leading at that level means you are shaping all of these different talents and personalities and capabilities, but it's what senior leaders do. And that's when I think about leadership now, it's not about me being the expert in the room. It's about me identifying who the expert is, making sure.
And get out of their way so they can do their thing.
Exactly.
How do you help organizations stay true to their values during transformation?
You see individuals and organizations have values and they talk a lot about them. And then when they're under pressure, you find out whether they really believe in those values. Because you say, we want to be this kind of organization, have this culture. But if money gets tight, suddenly people learn we're this kind of organization. So I think for organizations first is to understand what your values are. Be honest with yourself about your values. In our organization, we have ship, shipmate, self. And that means my highest priority is to the team. The next is to my teammates. Mm. And the last is to me. But if you actually go with the implications of that, that means if my biggest priority is to the ship, if I have to go down with the ship, I will. If I have to give my life jacket to my fellow member, I will. Those are big kind of commitments. So I think it's important to talk about values in an organization to say, are they just platitudes or are we serious? Are we going to treat people with respect? Are we going to be fair? Are we going to treat our clients first? Are we going to think about them? And if they are, then they become, in my view, really valuable because you can moor the organization to it. And nothing is better than when we see an organization that comes under pressure, it doesn't abandon its values. And suddenly what we hear from people inside and outside, they say, wow, when it got tough, that organization showed exactly what it was. And they were exactly what they said they were.
When you do have the tough times, it's a moment where you reaffirm and you actually anchor to your values and to your purpose. Is there anything that gives you pause about this era of rapid technological change?
What worries me most is probably us. I think that technology got ahead of our maturity to deal with it. What's happened is misinformation and disinformation has been given a stronger pathway, and we are not yet mature enough as a society to look at that and do due diligence. And we're busy. But so as a consequence, I think we have created divisions and opinions that are very dangerous, and not just in the United States, but worldwide. I'd like to believe that the natural evolution of people will be, we just get better consumers of information.
The product that we just launched, Health Answers by Pfizer, mm-hmm. you know, we want it to be credible, scientifically backed, you know, right. medical content. And so, you know, the partners that we're working with contribute to that.
Right.
So we wanted to create, you know, this capability that actually empowers a consumer to be able to, you know, ask a question, get a direct answer, but we also give you the sources that that answer came from.
Right.
So not only did we want to put credible, scientific-backed health information in the fingertips of consumers, it was precisely because we were seeing just how much is out there. My last question for you as we close out this, you know, great conversation, with everything we've discussed today, yeah. and after all it's said and done, right, where do you believe AI can take your work in the future?
It can make us be better. If you think of some of the tools that AI does, it can write something for you if you throw it ideas. Hopefully that will make us have a higher standard of what we write, because there's ability to get this sort of lowest common denominator, but it'll pull us up. It will require us to admit that the answer to any question we need is probably something we can find. And so there's not an excuse not to look for it. I'd like to believe that what AI can do was make us do simple things easier, mm-hmm. but do those things which are very important. Think at our health. What should I do about my health? How should I deal with this situation? What's my overall approach? Hopefully it would pull us up, like having really good advisors that are around. And all of us have got some, but it's hard to talk to them and whatnot. And AI could put that at our fingertips. So I'm excited by what it could do for our lives to make them better.
This has been great to see an old friend.
That's right.
That, you know, I've respected and admired for so many years. So thank you for being with us on this episode of The Power of Knowing. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely, joy for me. So thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us on this episode of The Power of Knowing. We learned that change is hard and can be upsetting. So it's important as a leader to bring people along on the journey. We also learned that it's important to stick to our values and our principles, especially during tough times. We also heard that AI can actually benefit high performers and amplify their effectiveness compared to others that are not leveraging AI. And the most important thing that I learned is that General Stan McChrystal said that I could be a general in the Army. Overall, this was a fascinating conversation. I hope you got as much out of it as I did. And see you next time.